in a weird position. I tend to write my talks last minute. Usually that works out really well because I'm an expert in the area that I'm talking about. And this is a talk about something that I'm not an expert at. In fact, there's at least four people in this audience who will probably be rolling their eyes and putting their hands in their faces as I talk about this, because I'm fairly new to scalaz ed. And it turns out it took me longer to get all my thoughts together and get things right than I liked. So the majority of this is there on slides. I might drop into some live coding. And some of it is really legitimately, it's okay to be unfinished, because I want to talk about the things that I understand, or at least think that I understand, and give you guys enough to go on to say, hey, this is pretty interesting. So how many of you have used scalaz ed before? What is that, about a third maybe? How many of you have heard of scalaz ed? More of you. How many of you were afraid of scalaz ed? Good, including several people who said they use scalaz ed. So this is a fairly reasonable thing, and that was part of it for me. A big part of where I saw things is that I spent a long time saying that we are not using the Z word. We're just not, because, first of all, I failed most of the math classes I took. I think the last math class I did well in was like algebra, and past that I probably had some bad math teachers, because I wish that I had found someone who inspired in me what I'm finding now, which is this stuff is cool. So I avoided this as, oh, I don't need these things. This is people being far too serious about their data structures, and what I have works fine. Until it didn't. Until I found these situations where it wasn't working and I went exploring down this road. I think there's also, to be fair, some reputations in the scalaz ed community of them being difficult to work with, of it being obscure. And what I found is that's really not true. There's some really helpful people, Eric Oschheim, Rob Norris, the bunch of other people who have just been, you know, incredibly patient and helpful as I go through trying to understand things. Because the other problem that I've had is, okay, I understand it. Now, how do I understand it so I can explain it to other people? And so, of course, I'm now at this point where I'm, you know, fairly happily using it and talking about scalaz ed on a regular basis. My coworkers don't look murderous as much when I talk about it and suggest it. And I've got at least two other people on my team of four that are using it, that have written code with it and been like, okay, I've convinced. There's two pieces I'm using, and I'm only convinced them of one of them. So I still have some work to do. And here is the important part. As I said, I've been playing with it a lot lately, and there's a lot that's in there. I don't understand all of it. I don't understand most of it. But I've started to understand the tools I need, and what I've found is that as long as I understand what I'm working with enough to be useful, that works. There's just so many things that are in there that you could spend years probably learning and mastering. But I'm making it valuable. So one of the situation that actually this started with for me was finding ways, because my team builds REST APIs, and we work with a UI team that builds Angular on top of that. And for me, it was finding better ways to collect and return errors when things went wrong with my system. And I was having a hard time with the tools that I had, and I'll show some of those examples, where using these scalaz ed tools was a huge, huge improvement. Can you guys see the slides with this color in the back?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
good.
Oh.
Okay. Is it possible to turn the lights back down?
Yeah, I got it.
That'll help. I'm just realizing, like, hey, can people see this? I think it's just the angle that I'm at is a little harder.
That can work through the video, all right? Cool.
Yay. All right. Cool. So the first thing that we came across, and the first thing I looked at, because I do a lot of things like collecting errors. With a lot of the work that I did early on my team was working with either, because I was dealing with a Jira API. So it was important, did this succeed and give me a successful thing, or did it fail and give me a throwable? And so Scala has this built-in object called either. It's pretty commonly used. It's got a left and a right projection. Now, convention, which means you don't have to do it this way, but most people do, and if you want people to not hit you when they look at your code, you should follow these rules. Convention says that left is an error, and right is some kind of success value. And it's a good concept, but it's actually pretty mediocre interaction. It's got some issues. So here is part of the problem with either, and I'm really tempted to switch my color scheme again. So I've instantiated an instance of right. I've just said right success, okay? And that gives me an instance of scalatil right. I haven't specified a type for the left, so that's just left as nothing. And I can test conditions. I can say success is right, success is left. But one of the things that I want to do is use it in a for comprehension. Use it as a monad. Because I probably have done a couple things like fetch from an option the value that of the ticket number that I need to look up in JIRA, and then I want to iterate over the result. So right here, I've already hit a limitation where I have to write hacky code to get around this instead of writing something that's elegant and somewhat idiomatic. So because it's not a monad, it's kind of a pain in the ass to work with. There is no flat map or map implementations here, and so we kind of have to force the right projection to do anything. And so you end up writing things like is right and then extracting it or whatever else. Which makes me want to build nuclear bombs and set them off. So there is an alternative that is offered by scalaz, which is backslash forward slash, which I had a hard time knowing what to call this. In scalaz, it's actually either.scala. But it turns out when you refer to either, then people aren't sure which either you're talking about. So I've been informed that the right name is disjunction. Also, I would love for someone to compile an awesome dictionary of the terms that people use, because there's some really great terms for all the symbols in scalaz that people have come up with. Disjunction looks a lot, like I said, it's either.scala. It actually looks a lot like either. It follows some of the same ideas. But it assumes that we want the right side, the success, most of the time. It has a right-hand bias. So that if we do things like treat it like a monad, it's going to assume that you're looking for the right side and therefore let us progress in that way. So this is a rough sort of console session. I've already had Lars yell at me for doing import scalaz dot underscore. I haven't figured out all of the clean imports yet. So apparently there are better imports that you can be more specific, and I haven't quite gotten there yet. There are some cool implicits that come into play. So you can have any value, any scala value, and call dot write on it. And you will get back an instance of a write disjunction representing that value. And this comes out here. You'll also notice all of a sudden that we've got this really confusing backslash forward slash dash. Easy way to remember it. The side of the backslash forward slash that the dash is on indicates that it's left or it's right. You're already remembering why you're not using scalaz, aren't you? I had some confusion with this early on, but kind of got there. But this is my success type, and obviously because I haven't provided information about nothing, there's some implied information that I still have to work with. And I can do the same thing with failure. Failure.left, I get a left back, right? And I can also say dash backslash forward slash failure. I think it was Lars who specifically told me, it was either Lars or Rob Nars who probably said, don't do that, do this. So don't instantiate it with dash backslash forward slash. Instantiate it with backslash forward slash dot left. Unfortunately, I haven't found an analog for doing matches, so you still have to kind of use the dash backslash forward slash. But there are tools there. You can get the instance you need. And so I can say the same backslash forward slash success, backslash forward slash dot right. Still get these things in. So I've got something that looks a whole lot like either. I can return a disjunction and get back a left or a right. Something I forgot to put on here is you can also, I forget what the exact term is for doing it, but instead of saying like backslash forward slash throwable comma string, You could actually describe the type in your return type as throwable space backslash forward slash string. What's the term for that kind of description?
Infix.
Okay. So that seems to be the best way to describe things. I think my colleagues have found that more readable. And it works very nicely. So now you're sort of saying the backslash forward slash is in the middle. You've got your left type and your right type, and there's no sort of question about how that's described. So I want to make a quick digression around scalaz option. Scala option, it's pretty commonly used as a container. It has a none and a sum. None has nothing in it. Sum has something in it. That part is really well named because I actually can remember what's in it. There are some downsides. There are some interesting issues, including the fact that the base trait option defines methods like get that you can attempt to get on the none and other things. But it has a bias towards a value. I can treat it like a monad and get things out of it. And so it will assume that I'm looking for sum. But this is actually the problem that led me to start to use scalaz, is that when you comprehend over a set of options, what you end up with is a failure, if there's anything that's none, and no idea where it failed. And so we have database objects. We sort of have our own homegrown database layer. So I might call get by ID. Here's the ID, and I get back an option of database object. And then that database object may have other case classes in it that represent joins or something else which are options. And so if I comprehend over that stack, and I fail at some point in that, I get none back. Now, how do I communicate to my API team? Well, the user ID you gave me didn't exist, or it's actually a malformed record and the join to the address table doesn't exist, or any other number of things. We have these partnerships that are actually an amalgamation of several different companies who may be a partnership with the same companies, but this company is responsible for this part of building something and this company's part of building another thing. And so there's another one. Well, if it's this type of project, there has to be this type of company in that partnership. And that's a common one as well. And if I'm comprehending over this stack, I can't adequately describe to somebody on the UI side, well, this was the problem. It wasn't your fault. What you sent me was perfectly fine. What happened was that we have a malformed database record. Instead, we return none, which then becomes, a 400 bad request or a 500 internal server error. And it really makes UI people happy because they love digging through Scala code. I mean, they write JavaScript, and that's fine. They're building stuff in Angular. It looks really cool. But they're not Scala programmers, so they don't want to have to dig through the code to figure out what went wrong, which means that now you're pair programming, one person who doesn't understand the language, another who does, digging through logs and trying to figure out what went wrong. That looks a lot like this. So I've defined a couple quick things to example. I've got a case class user with a first name and a last name. I've got a case class DB object. Gee, I wonder where that came from after all the years I spent doing MongoDB. I just realized that's a confusing name. So DB object has an ID of long, and then has a user, which is an option of user. It's a terrible example record, because why would I only have an ID and no user record? But you know, it's good enough for an example. So I've defined Brendan here, which is a sum of DB object with an ID and a user inside of it. This is pretty representative of the type of object that I work with fetching for my database. There's going to be probably an option hanging off of that that represents whatever it is that I'm looking for. And then there's some other guy who for some reason has a basic entry, but there's no user. So think about that. Brendan is an option of DB object, which is sum, with an option of user that's sum. Whereas other guy is a sum and a none. And so I wrote two quick methods. Get B gives me Brendan, get other gives me some other guy. I probably could have made that more elegant when you consider it. And here is a kind of bog standard comprehension. This is a lot like what we do. So early on, I insisted on making the terribly looking nested match after match after match, because at least with a case none, I could say what went wrong. And it's not, it looks ugly, it doesn't read well, it's hard to maintain. So a four comprehension is great, but only if I can find out what went wrong. So four, DA, you know, get B is a DAO. We know that's sum, so that's gonna be sum of a user. And DAO.user, which again breaks out from scala into user. Sum is the bias, so we assume if there's a value, that's what we're extracting. And yield user, and I get back an option of user, which is actually sum. I get back what I'm looking for. Great. But if I do this with the other guy, well, this is a sum of DB object, but it's got no user in it. And so when I extract the user, what happens? So, what's that? I get none. Because when you do a for comprehension over something like this, at any point, if any of your statements return none, the for comprehension short circuits, it basically aborts and returns back none to us. So imagine that there's 5 or 6 or 7 or 10 or 15 levels deep of these abstractions. Well, what went wrong? Was it the first, the second, the 10th, the 25th item that didn't have a value? And that's all I get back. Okay, well, I've got an option of user, which is none. And now I'm returning information to the front end that basically says, sorry, I don't know what went wrong. Why don't we spend 20 minutes digging through the logs? Which actually is a good error message. Is there an HTTP code for that? So, I mean, we talked about what went wrong here, which is that ultimately, yes, this is somewhat useful, but it doesn't return the information that I need to understand why it failed. And so, we do have a solution. I'm going to actually combine two things here to give the example. One is converting an option to a disjunction, because that's kind of useful, that's kind of cool. You can convert an option right to a disjunction. That was one of the first thing that I found. And it was great because I didn't have to rewrite all of the get methods on the database layer that return option. I can just take what I already have and convert it to a disjunction in line, as well as comprehending over disjunctions. I really should probably just refer to them as disjunctions here. So, we remember the get B and the get other methods that I wrote a few slides ago, right? Is anybody just asleep and not with me so far? Okay. So here, I've used, and actually to be fair, I started out using this because I went, nobody's gonna wanna see these extra symbols. So you can, on an option, you can call to write disjunction and provide an argument. So what you need to think of this like is get or else argument. When I say get or else argument, and it's sum, so let's say I have a user get or else no user found. What's returned? Okay, you're right. This is a separate issue with the fact that I'm using option. And another place where disjunction comes in mind. But if so with get or else, that argument is only if the value isn't there. And so it's the same thing here. When you say to write disjunction, what you're saying is please try to convert this to a disjunction of the right. And this argument is in case you can't do that, this is what I want you to return. And so that works fairly well. You could also say to left disjunction if you want to flip them around and confuse people. So there's this operator. I was not the one who introduced this operator. One of my coworkers introduced this, and then I went, what the hell is this? Which is backslash forward slash greater than. And I'm guessing that less than backslash forward slash is probably to left disjunction, but I haven't looked, to be honest. So this obviously reads a little cleaner when you write a for comprehension because there's less letters running you off the line. So get B returns an option of DB object, and I'm saying to write disjunction, no user by that ID. So what I can do is now if the user is none, I get whatever the disjunct, I'm sorry, if the DB object is none, I get no user by that ID. And if the DAO was there, but the user wasn't, well, hey, join fail, no user object. Great. Now, of course, this short circuits. The first item that isn't there is going to exit, but I get back a disjunction. So in this case, I got a write of a user, but here where we don't have a user object, I got a left. And this really helpful message that I can return to the front end. So I might still send a 400, but it's going to come with the message, the join failed, there's no user object. And my UI team is probably going to go, oh, I should talk to the right person about the fact that there's a database problem, rather than, hey, that call failed, do you know what happened? So it's communication through code, which means I have to interact with other people even less. It's a win-win. Wait, that's on camera. I probably shouldn't say that. No, I mean, the goal for me really is to make that interaction easier, because when you think about things, the UI and the backend are part of one product. And if they're separated out, then you're making interaction for everyone harder, and I like things to go well. So, as you know, I can just say none to write disjunction, symbol, no object found, or none to write disjunction, no object found. Everybody with me so far? Any questions about disjunctions? Yes, so the first thing that failed is going to exit, and that's what you're going to yield. So if I had six of them and the third one failed, then I will get back the disjunction for whatever that one is with the error message for that section that exited. Does that make sense? Does that answer the question? And coming back to, remember that I'm using this because it's useful, not because I want to hit the perfection of computing. I'm a hack. I dropped out of college. I have no idea what I'm doing half the time. And if my code compiles, I'm happy. But this stuff makes sense, and I'm starting to understand that better. But I think I almost go with that direction of, okay, it's useful, but this is working for what I need. I get back an error message if it fails, or I get back a success if it doesn't. And that, for me, is good enough. So I want to talk about validation. And this is the part where I probably have to jump into a little bit of live code to make it make sense. Validation looks similar to disjunction. And there are methods to implicitly convert. You can say dot disjunction on a validation and dot validation on a disjunction. The subtypes of validation are success and failure. Validation is not a monad, though. And this was a part where I was really confused, and anyone who was hanging out on Scala Zed will probably remember the 2 days when I was trying to figure out why this was happening. There were a bunch of examples out there for Scala Zed 6 that showed validation being used as a monad. And I think the short answer I got was that was a mistake that we fixed in 7. It was accidental. So validation is not a monad. You shouldn't be able to comprehend over it. It's an applicative functor. And so we validate all of the events with validation. Everything that we feed into it is validated instead of short-circuiting. So we say, hey, this is the stuff that I want back. And any failures in the chain win. So it ultimately, if there's any failures, then we lean towards failure. And all the errors get mashed together. So this uses mappend. So by default, all your error messages are going to get smushed together into one string if it's, if your failure is string, which not terribly useful. We'll look at a solution for that. Oh, that's good. Hold on. This is the downside of doing everything in Markdown. Or the upside. So this is actually a snippet of code that I grabbed from my code base. Huh? Oh. It keeps doing that to me. I know X, I keep forgetting that it's throwing it up in the other direction. So we've got a bunch of validation, and in this case, I validated something called a model group, and this is actually doing a non-empty list, which we'll talk about next, and combining it with a firmware version. Now, this is, I think, the home alone operator. I think before we knew it was the home alone operator, we argued about whether it was the Cinnabon stand or the TIE fighter. I still think TIE fighter is a better name, but... The which? Yes, the scream operator. See, this is the wonderful part about symbols. Nobody knows what they are, and so you can talk about the same operator and no one will be confused. This is one of the parts where I really do want like an English to scalaz dictionary, or better, a Dwarf Fortress to scalaz symbol dictionary, since I understand Dwarf Fortress better than I do scalaz symbols. In this case, this is combined all of them, and what this case statement is. If there's a failure, they're M appended together where you'll just get one string all together. If there's success, well, I have two separate objects that were returned here. I got a model group and a firmware version. So I say case and then the tuple because I'm extracting these out. And I can do what I need to do with this. Because ultimately what I was looking for is, was the model group valid? Was the firmware version valid? And if they were, then I want to actually create something out of these. And so you extract this out in the success. And I can return my result. Now, I read a bunch of articles that suggested that validation should be for your internal APIs, and you should focus on returning disjunctions externally. I think part of it is because the disjunction is more concrete, in that you've said this is success or this is failure, instead of having something that you can continue to apply other items to. So typically I will return it as a disjunction because I'm easily swayed by blogs that may or may not actually be authoritative apparently. But it worked for me. It was a useful piece of information from my point of view. Now, non-empty list is a separate thing. Did I paste the other one? Yeah, I put the other one in the wrong place. And again, I got a real quick, see? Yeah, I wish this had some kind of auto wrap on its own, but. There we go. Much better. So I actually, in this case, this was part of what I was doing. So there's another set of steps that comes back to improving my interaction with my UI team, which is before I start doing any work, before I start actually trying to process the request object in the database, I want to do a bunch of validations. This one was, we had an issue where there was a sequence that was sent with a request that it turned out we weren't checking whether there were any items in it. It was causing other issues. So this one just says, are there model items in here? And then this one is, hey, validate the names. Are they unique in our database? And this one is, validate the other thing, the names being unique. Oh, validate something, sorry, these validate some other conditions on there. This one does unique. And then there's a serial number that I have to check as well. Now, each of these independently returns a success or a failure object. But I want to combine them together. I actually don't care about the success in this case. And I forget who recommended the star greater than operator, and I don't know what the hell to call it, so it's the star greater than operator. But what this actually does is, it seems, at least the way that I'm using it, it drops my right-hand side, because I think I just returned unit from these. I'm not trying to accrue the success, because it's the same thing being fed into all of them. But what I get out of this is an appended set of failures. So if I use a regular string, then it's going to be an M append. But if I use this other thing, which is non-empty list, then it's something else. So non-empty list is one of those bits that I didn't get a chance to finish the slides. So a list, a regular list in Scala, can have how many elements?
Zero.
Say that again?
Zero to n.
Right, zero to n. Now, of course, the problem with that is, what if I want to say there needs to be at least one item? I don't want to authoritatively tell someone else I'm going to return you at least one item. So this is where non-empty list comes in, and it's I have a note here on it, so I don't sound like an idiot. It's a single linked list. It's guaranteed to have at least one element. So that also is known as it's not going to be empty if you return it. And there, it's very commonly used with validation because, as I said, if I just have a bunch of validations that return string failures, they're just going to get smushed together. But if I return a non-empty list, it's going to accrue each of those failures in elements of my non-empty list. And that's a lot more useful because now I can return an array of errors. Now, with that, there are a couple different things. Let's see if I can get a terminal window up. That's not the window I want. No, wait, that's the window I want. Bear with me here. How am I doing on time, by the way? Five? Okay. All right. So real quick, I probably will screw this up. That's okay. Like I said, I'm not an expert yet. Let's actually make this one Baz. So you notice, as I suggested previously, the problem here, of course, is that everything gets appended together into one jumbled up error message, which might be useful in some cases. Or I might want to return this list. So instead, I can say failure NEL, which implies that I want a non-empty list. And bar can be bar. And Baz can be Baz. Did that just run off the screen? Yeah.
You used the failure constructor instead of fail NEL for bar and Baz.
No. I got them all. It worked. I just had my terminal longer. So now I've got a failure of non-empty list of foo and bar and baz, and my terminal is still hanging off the screen. So the last bit on this, because this is just a quick taste, is it turns out that validation and non-empty lists go together quite often. And so there's a shortcut type called validation NEL, sorry, which is going to be like AB. Now, when you say validation NEL, what you're actually saying is that the left-hand side, the failure, will be a non-empty list. And so it's an implied type to make it easy to say, instead of having to say validation non-empty list AB. So you can say validation NEL. Cool? All right.
NEL is all caps these days, I think. That's why.
That's That might be it. You're right. Nope. You might be. Either way, I think as long as I got the basic information out there. Monad transformers are something that I struggled with maybe describing. I'm missing a slide here. Damn it. There's a cat picture that really describes. I'm serious, man. So real quick, because monad transformers are one of those things you all should look at. Essentially, you're inverting. So when I work with, I've started to play with them. When I work with Jira, for example, there are three conditions, really. I can have a failure, in which case JIRA gave me an exception. And I can have a success, but a success may not be a success. I might say get user from JIRA. And it's okay if there's no user. It's just going to give me an option. And so imagine you've got a disjunction of option. And then you've got to do these nested for comprehensions to pull them apart. So what monad transformers would give me in this case is like an option T where it's inside out. A cat in a box and a cat in a box in a box is a box. Roughly. So that's something you all should go look at because it's actually pretty damn cool. And somehow I forgot to put that on my slide. So the last thing I want to say before I close out, I hope that no one is surprised by this, but tests matter. Tests are really important. I sometimes forget to write tests, and then I wonder why nothing works. I've been building some cool tools for myself for doing scalaz testing with scalaz tests. So taking advantage of things like bias. How many of you have used scalaz test? How many of you use the option tools in scalaz test? Cool. So only a few of you. But in scalaz test, if you import this special import, you get an option back. You can say blah, 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 dot value. And that implies in scalaz test, unpack this if it's some or fail the test if it's none. It's really useful. And so given that something like disjunction is right biased, I've built similar tools like that. We use scalaz test at Netflix. Specs2, I also think, is pretty awesome. And there's already helpers for scalaz at typelevel.org for that. I am building, slowly but surely, a series of test helpers, which I'm looking to release in the next week or two. And then slowly a crew of, hey, here's all these really cool tools that I built to make it easier to test my scalaz code. And I know my teammates have not found this helpful, which means that it's not just me. And everybody needs a little buck. So a couple of quick bits, because I cheated off of this one, especially putting the talk together. Eugene Yukata has an awesome learning scalaz tutorial. He sort of linked it up with Learn You a Haskell for Great Good. So if you've read Learn You a Haskell for Great Good or you have a copy of it, you can kind of read a chapter of that, and then Eugene has linked articles that tell you more about how this applies in scalaz. Freenode on scalaz, really, really, really helpful, as long as you're willing to like completely be blown away by conversations that you don't understand. And a couple of people have been incredibly helpful to me, like Rob, Colt Fredrickson, Adalbert, and Miles, all of whom have like really, those are the people you should bother incessantly to get all of your answers and not leave them alone because they will help you. Questions?
We actually don't really have time.
Okay. All right. Well, hopefully that was helpful to people, and thank you.